Welcome to this class. We were discussing the case analysis. How should you go about analyzing the case? So, when we discussed this, we looked at some measures of financial performance. And when we looked at some measures of financial performance, we considered the ROI, we considered EPS, then the ROE, then the EVA, then the MVA. EVA standing for the economic value added, MVA standing for the market value added. Then we also looked at the stakeholder measures, the stakeholders being consumers, suppliers, financial community, then employees, government, then consumer advocates, and the environmentalists. Now, after having looked at these measures of financial performance, let us now look at some key financial ratios today. So, these are the ratios which are of interest to us. One is the profitability ratios. They are listed here. I will be discussing each one of them in greater detail. So, when we look at profitability ratios, we look at gross profit margin, then the operating profit margin, then the net profit margin, then the return on total assets, then the return on stockholders' equity, then the return on common equity, then the earnings per share. All this we are going to discuss in greater detail. Now, let me just take you down to some of the formula which we have already listed. We have looked at the different types of, in the last class we looked at for the financial performance, the different shareholder group measures, stakeholder measures, and we listed all of them. Now, in a similar manner, let us look at these financial ratios. What does gross profit margin mean? Gross profit margin. How do you calculate this gross profit margin? This gross profit margin is calculated by sales minus the cost of goods sold divided by the sales revenue. So, the gross profit margin is calculated by sales minus cost of goods sold divided by the sales revenue. What does it tell you? It gives you an indication of the total margin available to cover operating expenses and yield a profit. So, it tells you what is the whether how by how much have you been able to cover the cost of goods or the operating expense, cover the operating expenses and get a profit over through your sales. Then what is the operating profit margin? How do you calculate this operating profit margin? So, the operating profit margin is nothing but profit before taxes and interest. Before taxes and interest divided by sales revenue. So, before the company pays money on taxes and interest, the profit earned divided by the sales revenue. What does it tell you? It gives you an indication of the firm's profitability from current operations without regard to the interest charges accruing from the capital structure. So, the company has not yet paid taxes, kindly note, which is due to the government and maybe other bodies also. So, this is before this. So, how much is a profit margin? Then, when you take it after taxes, you get the net profit margin. You get the net profit margin. So, the company has paid everything which is due to the different bodies, then it will get on hand what exactly is the margin on profits. So, the sales revenue. So, shows after tax profit per rupee of sales. Subpar profit margins indicate that the firm's sale prices are relatively low, or that its costs are relatively high, or both. Suppose the company is not able to really get profit margins after this, it shows that its operating costs are high, or its sales prices are relatively low, that is, it could have priced its product higher in the marketplace, not doing it. So, both or both. So, this is the type of implications each one of these ratios has, that is, a gross profit margin, operating profit margin, net profit margin. Then the next one we are interested is what we call the return on assets. How do we calculate the return on total assets? So, in fact, the return on total assets, how do you calculate this? It is equal to profit after taxes, profit after taxes divided by total assets, or there is another formula, profit after taxes plus interest divided by total assets. So, this is the other formula, method of calculating this. So, what does it tell you? A measure of the return on total investment in the enterprise. This is what I mentioned in the last class. Why will you invest in a company? Suppose your investment is not fetching you the returns, let us say, why should you invest in such a company? What is the return on investment? These are the questions which keep on cropping up in a mundane manner, routine manner in the industry. So, you talk of something, they keep on asking you these figures. So, you wanted this much money. How much? So, this is the investment that is made, how much this money has brought in, okay? That is, what is the return on this to the company? So, the return on total assets similarly is, you have made use of the assets of the company to produce products. Suppose it is a manufacturing company, it can be your production lines, the type of equipment that you are making use of, all this to produce the products, and you have introduced them into the market, and after introducing them into the market, you expect the sales to reflect a certain amount of return, which every company expects will yield a reasonable profit margin. Okay, this is what it normally means. A measure of the return on total investment in the enterprise. It is sometimes desirable to add interest or after tax profits to the numerator of the ratio, Since total assets are financed by creditors as well as by stockholders, hence it is accurate to measure the productivity of the assets by the returns provided to both classes of investors. Suppose so many people have paid to create assets, that is paid to the company to create assets, that is a company has borrowed, then you add that interest which is given to these firms as well. So, this is both measures are accepted measures of calculation for ROE. Similarly, the next one which we are interested is return on stakeholders equity, return on stakeholders on stockholders equity, return on stockholders equity. How do we calculate this? Return on stockholders equity is calculated by profit after taxes. Kindly note all this formula carefully and divided by the total stockholders equity, divided by the total stockholders equity. So, after the taxes, so suppose how much is the stockholders equity. So, how much of the stockholders investment is there in the enterprise. So, what is the measure? What is the return? What does it give you? It gives you a measure of the rate of return on the stockholders investment in the enterprise. Suppose you have invested 100 rupees, you expect a return more than the bank return as an individual investor. So, this is what I was trying to tell you in the other classes also. So, if you are getting for 100 rupees 1 rupee, you need not have invested that in this particular company, because even putting that 100 rupees in a bank, in a savings account, will get you more than that 1 rupee. It gets you 3.5 rupees at the present rate of interest, okay, without any risk involved, or the risk is negligible. Okay. Similarly, if you are a little forthcoming or having some enterprising spirit, you can make investment in company deposits of good companies, earn a much higher rate of interest than the fixed deposit rates of interest in a bank. You may get it even around 9 to 10%. So, your 100 rupees will be getting you 10 rupees. Suppose you want to make an investment in a particular company, what are you expecting? You are expecting a rate of return which is higher than these rates of return. So, you expect something more than 10. This is the way you have to look at it as an individual investor. Now, this is one way of calculating the return on stockholders. This is the way of looking at return on stockholders equity. Then we can also look at return on common equity. Return on common equity. This return on common equity we can calculate using the formula profit after taxes, minus preferred stock dividends, divided by the total stockholders equity, minus par value of preferred stock, So, you are looking at profit after taxes minus the preferred stock dividends, that is the some people have this preferred stock, what is the dividends due to them you have to pay. So, you will come to the common equity holders after these stocks, preferred stock dividends are paid, then the totals divided by the total stockholders' equity minus the par value of the preferred stock. What does this give you? It gives you a measure of the rate of return on the investment that the owners of the common stock have made in the enterprise. Owners of the common stock have made in the enterprise. That means to say, let us say you have some 100 people investing in a particular enterprise. They all form this common equity, common stockholders. They come into that category. Suppose let us say you have 10 people who are holding, who have made, what do you call, capital investments in the enterprise, then they are the owners of the firm. 100 people picking up equity, hypothetical examples. So, they are coming under the common equity pool. So, when you are saying return on common equity, you are 10 people. So, the 10 people are the preferred stockholders. These 100 people are forming the common equity. Now, you calculate the formula on the return on the return on common equity. It tells you how is the company able to pay, or how is it able to give, provide the return on this common equity. So, a measure of the rate of return on the investment that the owners of the common stock have made in the enterprise. Now, this is return on common equity. Then the last one which we are interested is earnings per share. The earnings per share is calculated by profit after taxes. Note that we are looking at profit in most of these calculations after taxes. Why are we looking at after taxes? So, there is no further encumbrance on this profit figure. So, after these taxes are paid. So, profit after taxes minus the preferred stock dividends, minus the preferred stock dividends. So, these people are preferred stockholders divided by the number of shares of common stock outstanding, of number of shares of common stock outstanding. So, gave you the example in the last calculation. So, these 10 are the owners, let us say 100 people having equity, let us say hypothetical case 100 shares, one share, not really true. So, after paying the profit after taxes, the earnings per share, what does it tell you? It shows the earnings available to the owners of the common stock. So, after these preferred stock dividends are made, so these 10 people have made investments. So, for them, you pay out the dividends at a particular rate, decided rate, which you have come to agreement even before this other equity was distributed, that is a common equity was. So, there is a certain amount of fixed dividends to be paid for these preferred stockholders. So, the profit after taxes minus the preferred stock dividends divided by the number of shares of common stock outstanding, it will give you the earnings per share. So, what does it tell you? It tells you the earnings, it gives you the earnings available to the owners of the common equity. So, these different ratios which we listed till now, they broadly come under the umbrella of the profitability ratios. So, just to repeat, the profitability ratios are gross profit margin, operating profit margin, net profit margin, then the return on fixed total assets, then the return on the stockholders' equity, then the return on common equity, then the earnings per share. So, all these coming under the umbrella of profitability ratios. Now, we look at another important category of ratios. These are called liquidity ratios. These are called liquidity ratios. This is liquidity ratios. What are these liquidity ratios? We are looking at some of these are some of the important ratios. One is what is called the current ratio. Current ratio is nothing but the current assets divided by the current liabilities. What does this give you? It indicates the extent to which the claims of short term creditors are covered by assets that are expected to be converted to cash in a period roughly corresponding to the maturity of the liabilities. So, translated into mundane terms, what does it mean? Suppose let us say your current assets are rupees, let us say is equal to rupees 200 and your current liabilities is equal to rupees 100. What does that mean? Your current assets is able to take care of your current liabilities by a margin of 2:1. That is, your current assets is 2 and your current liabilities is 1. So, this is the way it is, 2:1. So, your current assets always higher than the current liabilities. This is what normally the financial institutions or the financial community, they look for when advancing loan to different companies. They say, they look at these types of ratios. What is the liquidity ratio of the company? How is it? They always prefer this 2:1 to be the minimum acceptable level at which they can lend for the firm. The other ratio which the companies look at is also called quick ratio. What is quick ratio? You are looking at the same current ratio, but adding one more term into this, that is current assets minus the inventory divided by current liabilities. So, why do you want to add this, take this inventory? You want to take this inventory because inventory is something which you feel may not be able to convert immediately. Suppose you are not able to convert immediately, then you want to find out through the quick ratio by how much is the current assets covering the current liabilities without taking into account the inventory. So, a measure of the firm's ability to pay off short term obligations without relying upon the sale of inventories. He does not have to sell the inventories. So, does not have to really go after a buyer for the inventories. Says that yes, this is we are able to cover. In fact, an ideal thing would be your quick ratio at least at 2:1. So, the company is better off. So, able to meet the obligations much better. Then the inventory to net working capital. Inventory to net working capital. Net working capital. This is calculated by inventory inventory divided by current assets minus current liabilities. So, you take the stock of the inventories divided by current assets minus current liabilities. What does it give you? It gives you a measure of the extent to which the firm's working capital is tied up in inventory. So, this is a very fairly important ratio. So, whenever we look at a small scale enterprise or a medium scale enterprise, we always look at this ratio. How much of inventory is locked up? How much of the money is locked up in the inventory? The main problem with many of the small scale industries forcing to close doors or forcing to close the shutters is this problem of working capital, not able to get money for working capital. Why they are not able to get money for working capital? We can only say that the financial management could have been better. So, what are the indicators of this? One of the very strong indicators of this is the inventory to net working capital. So, given by this calculation, inventory divided by the CA minus CL, that is the current assets minus the current liabilities, gives you the extent to which the firm's working capital is tied up in inventory. So, a very important ratio. So, all these three, that is the current ratio, then the quick ratio, then the inventory to net working capital, they all come under the category of liquidity ratios. So, these are called liquidity ratios. There are three of them. One is current ratio, quick ratio, and inventory to net working capital. Then the next type of ratios we are interested is what is called the leverage ratios. Leverage ratios. What are these leverage ratios? Some of the ratios I will list them out for you. One is debt to assets. Debts to assets. So, as you could have almost made out by now, how much have you borrowed? What is the asset created? What is the coverage this asset is able to have on the debts? That is the total debt divided by the total assets. Total debts divided by the total assets. So, this is the way this whole formula gets calculated. So, what does it tell you? As I told you, measures the extent to which the borrowed funds have been used to finance the firm's operations. So, how much of the debts which you took from the different companies, how much of it you have used up to create assets for the firm. So, many times this is what we are seeing in the present day context. Not that it was not there earlier as all earlier, it was there, but nowadays we are seeing many of these financial improprieties being resorted to by many entrepreneurs. Take loan in the name of one company to create assets, but assets are created for some other company. Not the right thing to do, because this can always be detected and doesn't speak well of the financial management. So, these leverage ratios can be very helpful in calculating or in finding out all these types of discrepancies which the companies might have done. Not that all companies do, So, suppose a company does it, then it can be detected by these types of ratios. Then the next one is debt to equity. Debt to equity. So, what is, how do you calculate this? You calculate this taking the total debt divided by total debt divided by the total shareholders' equity. Total shareholders' equity. What does it give you? The total debt divided by the total shareholders' equity. What does it give you? It gives you, provides a measure of the funds provided by creditors to that provided by owners. So, the, if you really see the previous one, the instead of the shareholders, kindly, this is the stockholders' equity, kindly note the change in the formula, the total stockholder equity, what does that mean? This much money is available both from the preferred stockholders as well as the other persons who have contributed to the equity of the firm. So, these equity holders in that sense are the owners of the firm. So, how much money they have been able to bring? Suppose let us say your total debt is 200 rupees and your total stockholders' equity is 100 rupees. So, for 100 rupee, you are able to raise 200 rupees, that is 2:1. So, this is the normal financing range at which financial institutions fund companies. They say bring 100 rupees, we will be able to give you 200 rupees. So, what does it mean? It means that your 100 rupees plus his 200 rupees should be able to pay off his 200 rupees through the operations of the firm. That is what he expects. So, they say you bring 100 rupees, we will finance you up to 200 rupees. So, 2:1 normally is the way they look at these ratios. So, debt to equity provides a measure of the firm's funds provided by creditors to that provided by the owners. Then the next one is long term debt to equity ratio. Long term debt to equity ratio, long term debt to equity ratio. So, what is this long term debt? So, this long term debt is given to the company for 5 to 10 years, there is a certain moratorium also available to the company. So, for 1 or 2 years, the company need not pay, make any return on this. So, this is calculated by the formula long term debt divided by the total stockholders' equity. So, this is a widely used measure of the balance between debt and equity in the firm's long term capital structure. So, this is used by most of the financial institutions. Suppose let us say a state financial institution given loan, long term loan up going up to repayment period going up to 10 years. So, first 2 years of operation or 3 years of operation of the firm, no installments to be paid. Installments to start from the commence from the 4th year of operation. So, what does it mean? It means that the financial institution expects the firm to be healthy or in a position to start paying back after 3 years. Okay. So, it has almost covered the entire operating costs, able to make reasonable profit margins, and that it is in a position to start repaying the different financial creditors, the long term creditors, that is financial institutions. So, this is what these long term financial institutions are looking for. So, they, in order to ensure this, what do? They would like to place a nominee director from that institution on the board of this firm. His main job is to ensure that the money which is due in terms of the EMIs due to the financial institution, they are paid in time. Okay. Suppose he started, suppose the company starts defaulting in the payment of returns every month or every quarter, whatever it may be, then the director or the nominee director of on behalf of this financial institution, he will have to chip in the board meeting and say, first clear the dues of these financial institutions. Of course, there are certain classes. How many financial creditors are there? What is the charge? Who is having the first charge? Who is having the second charge? All these types of things. But generally, the companies do discharge the liabilities to long term debts after a certain period. But a very important ratio which is used by financial institutions. The other one is what is called the times interest earned, times interest earned. What does this mean? The times interest earned stands for the profit of before interest, profit before interest and taxes, before interest and taxes plus the lease obligations. Suppose you have lease obligations, plus the lease obligations divided by the total interest earned before for this, in this first case we do not take the lease obligations, we just take the profit before interest and taxes divided by the total interest charges. So, we want to make this at this level a little simpler. The total interest, the times interest earned is the profit before interest and taxes divided by the total interest charges. What does this give you? It gives, it measures the extent to which the earnings can decline without the firm becoming unable to meet its annual interest costs. So, it gives you an idea how much the earnings may decline, but the firm is able to meet the annual interest cost. So, but by how much is the earnings declining, can decline. So, this is what you are trying to say. So, what is the total interest charges? So, what is the profit that you have earned before interest and taxes? By how much time is it covering? Now, let us say you want to make this a little more stringent. You want to look at it in a little more stringent way. That is, you want to see how, by how much is the charge getting covered. That is the fixed charge coverage. Suppose you want to do that, fixed charge coverage. Then you are going to take into account the lease obligations. That is the profit before interest and taxes, profit before interest and taxes plus the lease obligations. So, there may be obligations of lease divided by the total interest charges plus the lease obligation. So, in other words, you are not really going to have a great difference between this ratio and the other ratio. To me, it may be, it can be a more inclusive way of doing things, that is a more inclusive indication of the firm's ability to meet all its fixed charge obligations. So, there may be a charge, that is what I just mentioned, first charge, second charge, all these types of things which they say in financial terminologies, which the firm is to meet. So, this is the next one which you may have to do. So, this is the other category of ratios, that is the leverage ratios. We are looking at debt to assets, we are looking at debt to equity, we are looking at long term debt to equity ratio, we are looking at times interest earned, then the fixed charges charge coverage. The next category of ratios which we are interested is called activity ratios. In these activity ratios, some of the ratios which we are interested is the inventory turnover. How do you calculate this inventory turnover? This inventory turnover is calculated by sales revenues divided by inventory of finished goods. Inventory of finished goods. What does it give you? When compared to industry averages, it provides an indication of the whether the company has excess or inadequate inventory of finished goods. So, it is very important for a company to sell its finished goods stock. Suppose its finished goods is lying in the yards of the company, then what is it going to add up to? It is going to add up to the cost of holding of these finished goods, that is the inventory of the finished goods. To that extent, your sales revenue is locked up. So, you are not able to sell this finished goods in the market or not able to push it in the market in time to convert it into cash. That is what it means. So, it is always desirable for a firm to have less of inventory of finished goods. So, many of these reputed automotive manufacturers, so you have to wait before you get your automotive car or whatever. So, most of these reputed manufacturers like say Toyota, you order for the car, say a Toyota Corolla, does not come to you immediately, that is you order today, it is not available for you tomorrow. He says it will take about 2 to 3 months before the car could be delivered. So, that means to say some of the processes are gone through and ensured that all the quality checks and other things are gone through before the car is delivered. So, the inventory of the finished goods is held to the minimum by the company. Similarly, you have fixed assets turnover. What is this fixed assets turnover? Fixed assets turnover, it is given by the sales revenues divided by the fixed assets. What does it tell you? It tells you a measure of the sales productivity and utilization of the plant and equipment. How much of your plant and equipment you have made use of to convert or to make into finished goods or to into your production line to come out with finished goods. So, this is a measure of the sales productivity and utilization of the plant and equipment. Then the other one is what is called the total assets turnover. Total assets turnover, again given by sales revenue divided by total assets. What does it give you? It gives you a measure of the utilization of the firm's assets. A ratio below the industry average indicates the company is not generating enough volume of business given the size of its assets investment, which is not again good for the company, then this is with respect to the inventories and the assets. Now, we are also interested in what is due for the company, that is what is called the accounts receivable turnover, it is calculated by the annual credit sales, divided by the accounts receivable. What does it mean? So, to put it to you in a very simple manner, let us say a company says we have sold 100 rupees goods. That is, the company is telling that we have sold 100 rupees worth goods. Then as an auditor you say, give me the 100 rupees as the sales revenue. It tells it is accounts receivable. What do you mean by that? We have given this 100 rupees sales on credit. This money is due to us, not at received by us. So, this money is due to us. So, he has not yet paid the money. Now, the next question comes is, see, this is where many of these retailing trade businesses operate. A simple example could be, you are, let us say, supplying some commodities to a supermarket store, let us say like this big bazaar. Let us say you send or you give 100 units to this big bazaar person. Now, do you get the money immediately? He says no, it will be given after a certain period, lock-in period, which he says 90 days, sometimes 6 months. So, depending on what is the item that you are giving him. Now, why is he saying so? He wants to ensure there is a movement of the item that you gave him. So many mobile phone manufacturers give the mobile, but that particular model of the mobile may not move at all, then how does he pay? So, this is the way the companies look at it. That is the asset. Now, for the mobile company, that particular person, he may say, I have given this on credit sale, but till you receive the money, the sale is actually not through. Kindly note that. This is annual credit sales divided by the accounts receivable gives a measure of the length of time it takes the firm to the sales made on credit. This is what I just explained to you. The other one which we are interested is what is called the average collection period. This is equal to the accounts receivable, that is the accounts receivable divided by the total sales plus 365 for the annual days, or the accounts receivable divided by the average daily sales. So, this is the other method of calculating this. What does it give you? It indicates the average length of time the firm must wait after making a sale before it receives payment. So, what is the track record of the firm in getting this money? That is the average collection period. So, many of the banking institutions also, they lend loans to so many people. then the question is how to recover this loan. Many times some of these people who have taken the loan from the bank, they are hard nuts. They are either not traceable, don't pay the loan on time, all those things. So, then what do many of these, especially these cooperative banking institutions, you might have seen loan, there is a vehicle, on that vehicle there will be a big board, loan recovery vehicle. That loan recovery vehicle, suppose it stands in front of a house, what does it indicate? It indicates to the other persons that this particular house owner has taken money from this particular bank, has defaulted in payment, so this vehicle is coming and standing there. So, back to what you call the mythological tale of Harishchandra owing money to Vishwamitra. So, what did Vishwamitra do? He put Nakshatrika in charge and told, get the money which is due from Harishchandra. So, this vehicle is standing like a Nakshatrika from the bank in front of the house, but it also conveys a very bad connotation to other neighbors, so which every owner would like to avoid. So, these are some of the ratios which we are interested in. There are some other ratios also which we are interested. We will have a look at those ratios also in the next class. Thank you.